Genesis 11, 1 through 9, the Tower of Babel. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its tops in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down, and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth.
Thank you, Jeffrey. It's great to be able to see everybody today and be able to worship God today. It's always a good time to be able to think about all the great things that God has done for us. In just a couple weeks, we're going to be having a marriage and family seminar, and so I want you to be thinking about that. And also, at that time, there's going to be a potluck, so I want you to be thinking about the food. I know all the men are thinking about the food. Maybe women will catch on here. But that's not what we're doing today. Today we're talking about this God of self-help and how all of that fits with us together. So the passage that Jeffrey has just read is dealing with the Tower of Babel and about how all this happened. It's a time after Noah, but it's before everything else. It's before there's any law, before there's any rules. There's not any law that they're supposed to have. I mean, they're supposed to know not to kill each other from the time of Cain and Abel, but there really isn't any other direction from God. And so as you look at this, they have all come together. They have joined each other. They understand what this is all about. They have one language. They all understand that language, and they all say it very well, so that they don't really have, I don't know if they have arguments or disagreements, but they're all solved, it seems like. And so they all get along. They're all able to build. They're all able to do all of these things together. And God doesn't like it. Huh. Isn't that what we would like? Isn't that what we're trying to do? Is for everyone to communicate well, for everyone to get along, to have a country where everybody understands all of these things, where we all can have rights and speak and do, and everybody gets along, and it all works. And God says, there's nothing impossible for them now. There isn't anything that they set their mind to do that they couldn't do. Well, that's a pretty good recommendation from God, isn't it? And it seems like that's exactly what we want. And God says, but that's not what I want. Well, who cares what God wants? I mean, can't we do it ourselves? And I think we better back up there. Maybe we shouldn't get to the who cares what God wants. Because since there's no law, they haven't done anything wrong, so there's no punishment. God doesn't even say that they've done anything. There's no punishment that comes as a result of this. He says, well, I'm just going to go down and I'll just confuse their language a little bit. I'll give them some different languages. And even today, there's a group that meets part of us right in the other side of the building that's now speaking Spanish. Every time I meet someone who speaks Spanish, they tell me that was the language originally that God spoke. And the rest of us are just slow to catch on, but I'm not so sure about that. But when you think about that, we think about what it is that God wants. They were able to build the this incredible tower to make a name for themselves, because we all want to stay together. We all are proud of ourselves. We're proud of what we've accomplished. We see that the future is bright and everything is going to be able to be done. And it sounds perfect, doesn't it? And the shock is that God doesn't want that. Why? Doesn't God care about us? Well, yes, he does. But this isn't our world. And it's not because we get to take it over and leave him out. He created it, and now it's ours. God, thank you very much. And we're going to run it from here on out. That's really not the case. We understand that spiritual things belong to God, but a whole lot of other things belong to God as well. The importance of everything belongs to God. What it's all about, the reason why we're here, the center of everything should be focused on God and on who he is. And when we decide how to build our own society and our own place and have everything work just perfectly, he says, wait a minute, you forgot one thing. This is my world. And the reason we're here is for his world. And so as we begin to look at things and try to understand how all this works, it's a matter of who do we focus on? Today there's a whole lot of self-help books out. I am not against self-help books. If you've got one that's helping you, great. That's good. I just don't want that to become the religion, because I don't think God wrote those. I don't think that's the place where we can use those as the word of God. We can use them for what they were intended. They're one person's opinion of how to better your life. And some of them are very, very good and very effective. I didn't put a whole bunch of them up here. Self-help can be good, because it's actually, we see that in the Bible a lot. But self-help makes a very poor God. And when we make self-help God and make it the center of everything, it really doesn't help. Well, there are some people who did a lot and were able to accomplish a lot. One of those people was Noah. This is a replica that has been built in our time. And so the ark actually existed back then. The ark actually exists today. I'm hoping that doesn't mean there's a flood. But just in case there is an ark, it's not in Arizona, however, so it may take a while to get there. But God came and told Noah there's going to be a flood, and he announces this to him, and he says, I want you to build an ark. And so, Noah, you're able to have this salvation, because I'm going to destroy sin in the world by a flood, and I want you to save yourself and to help yourself by building this boat. Build this ark. And it's for you and your family and for all the animals. And so he gives him this project. Isn't that a self-help project? I'm helping myself to be able to survive the flood, and not sure how many Google attempts he made at trying to find ark plans, but, you know, God kind of gives him the basics of what all's supposed to happen there. Do it for yourself. Take care of yourself. But at the same time, he did not go into the ark building business. He built the ark for him, exactly what was supposed to happen. And he built it because God asked him to build it. And his first step out of the ark was to build an altar to God, praising God, because God is in the center of all things. It is not arks. Even though an ark might be very useful in a time of a flood, it isn't the fact that we were able to save ourselves from something and thereby use that as the center of our life. So I hope you get what I'm trying to say here. There's a lot of times where people are expected to act. They're expected to do things. Israel is found in Egypt, and God wants to deliver them. How are they going to get to this promised land? God doesn't have a shuttle. He said, we're going to walk. You're going to walk from Egypt to Israel? Don't you realize this is a desert? Don't you realize how far that is? And you're going to take people who have never governed themselves and never gotten along, and this isn't the Babel people. This is the gripey, complainy people. And they're coming out of Egypt, and they're so scared, and they're so afraid of everything. They don't know how to do anything, and now they're going to go to a promised land. And by the time he gets there, it's, well, you go in and take it. What, you couldn't even clear out the land? You left giants in the land? Yes. I'm going to give it to you, but you go in and take it. And we see this happening a lot. And so they're very closely tied together, this idea of us doing something that will benefit us, because it does. But also, it is what comes from God. And those two things need to be tied very closely together. And so as we look at all of this, we can see how all of this works, and we can see that, yeah, they had to go in and conquer and fight, but, you know, they won every single battle when they were with God. And when they weren't with God, the battles didn't go so well. Well, a lot of self-help is focused on success, and so let me give you a success story that comes in the Bible. It's found in Mark chapter 10 and verse 17. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and he knelt before him and he asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these I have kept from my youth." And Jesus, looking at him, loved him. Said to him, "You lack one thing. Go and sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Here's the success story, if there ever was one. It looks like he's the perfect guy. He has some money. We learn from other passages that this is an older guy, this is a young guy. We learn he's also a ruler in the people. He is a leader. He's one of those guys who is in the forefront. He is one that is a success if there ever was one. He would have graduated from the highest school with honors. He would have been able to do everything. And he comes to Jesus in his humility and says, "What do I have to do to be saved?" He has already been following God. He's already kept the law of God. He already recognizes Jesus as the Son of God, as that Savior. And he says, "You just need to focus your life. What else do I have to do?" I would love it if I could ask Jesus, "What else do I have to do?" And he only had one thing. I think the list is going to be a lot longer if I ask the question, so I may not want to ask that question just yet. But he asked it. He's done everything that the law said. He's kept it all. Well, at least he says he's kept it all. Not sure if we can trust everything. But then Jesus says to him, "You've made this great life for yourself. Now I want you to learn how to focus on God. Because you've built this. You've got the talent. You have been able to amass some wealth. You have... But it's not about you. It's about God." And so he says, "I want you to walk away from all of this. I want you to give it to the poor," which means it will be gone. "Sell everything, give it to the poor, and come follow me." That's pretty hard to do, isn't it? How about Jesus, if I fund your ministry? I'll take all of my riches and I'll put it into your ministry. So at least I'll know that this is going to a good place, and I'll have a place here because we can put it into the things we want to put it into. That's not what Jesus said. Give it to the poor, and you know what happens then? It will all be gone. He says, "The poor you're always going to have with you." And it doesn't make the poor rich. It just makes the money gone. And so when you think about this and understand what it is that he's asking, the young man is a little bit upset. But I picked the Mark passage because of one phrase in here. Jesus looking at him, loved him. I don't know what that says to you, but Jesus is so impressed with this guy. Jesus thinks this guy is great. Jesus thinks this is wonderful. He loves him. He says, you just got to fix this part. You're focused on your business. And I don't want you to think that your business is going to support everything, but you need to understand what this is all about. Go and sell it all and come follow me. And he walks away. Jesus doesn't punish him. That's not the point. He spent his whole life doing what was right. He had done everything right. He is a self-made man. But he is not a God-made man. And that makes a huge difference. He had his treasure on earth. And that's where it will stay. Because he's not willing to give up the treasure on earth to have the treasure of heaven. So what help did this man need? How would you help him? Well, it looks like he doesn't need any help, does he? No, he needs a lot. Because he needs that focus to be a God man, to be one that follows Jesus Christ. Because he's made it so far, but he still recognizes there's something missing. What else am I missing? And then he's unwilling to give up the security of what he's had to be able to do that. Well, that's the side of success. So sometimes when we think about self-help, we think about success. How do I become a success? Those are the books I want to make me a success. The other side of this whole question is, I've got a problem. And what is it that I can do to solve my problem? And a lot of times our approach to God is not, God make me a success, it's God help me with my problem. And so, God, I pray to you, I want you to fix this, I want you to do this for me, I want some way for you to be able to fix it all. And when that doesn't help, we decide that we're going to read a self-help book, and we're going to teach us how to be a nicer person, we're going to teach us how to forgive, how to have relationships, how to be financially independent, how to forgive someone else, how to be forgiven ourselves, how to deal with anger, how to deal with patience, or maybe how to have more patience, trying to have self-control, trying to find happiness, because we seem to, in our search for happiness, we have this destructive behavior that doesn't really bring happiness. And so, how do we do that? How do we find the right book that tells us how to do all of those things that we're going to need to do in order to be happy? We don't build a happy life or get control without God. That's just where it all comes down to. We can't find that with our destructive behavior. We can't find that without God. And so the self-help solution sounds something like this. I can help myself. All I need is better discipline and to not make the same mistakes. I can read a book in private. I can fix myself by adjusting or understanding. So it's either education or behavior, and changing one of those two will give me what I want. Problems don't need to be forgiven. They just need to be understood. We are not forgiven of problems. That part is not in Scripture, but we are recognized as people with problems, and so I just need acceptance. As a person with problems, like you are a person with problems, and we'll all just kind of overlook that and not worry about it and give each other acceptance and just say, well, you know what, you're okay, I'm okay. We'll all just be okay, right? And so if we can just ever get that in, we're not going to judge each other because we understand we're all in the same situation. And that's really where we come down to. Some people's problems have other consequences. We don't really have to solve all those. We just have to be able to get along. So, well, some of that sounds good. Are we not supposed to solve problems if we would know how? No. if you know how to fix something, if you know how to solve a problem, do it. Okay? That would be great. God has given us reason and ability, and we can solve problems of our own, and we can solve problems of other people. We can come up with solutions. So what's the issue? Problems are not why we're here. We're not here just to build a better society. We're not here just to extend our life and cure all disease. We're not here just to get rid of all the things that would do away with us. And if we could just do that, then everything would be perfect. Let me see if this example will work for you. Some of you have children. Why in the world did you do that? Okay, you already got that. It complicates everything, doesn't it? I mean, grandchildren I can understand because you give those back. But the children part is the harder part. Because there is so much stuff you have to carry with a baby. And I can remember this far back. You know, we were just going to somebody else's house for dinner. It's, well, you need a diaper bag and the special chair that the child has to sit in because we don't want the child to be damaged. And, well, we're going for dinner, so you need to put the high chair as well. And they need collapsible ones of those, so, okay, we'll put that in the trunk. And then, you know, it might be late, so you're going to need a place for them to sleep. So you need this pack and play that folds up like a little screen mesh thing that you can put them in so they can't get out. Basically a jail. But we need that because we don't want to have to watch them all the time. And then you need all the toys, and they might not like that toy, and they might like this toy, and these are quiet toys, and these are loud toys. And these are toys that run, and these are toys that they can chew on because they've been chewing a lot of things lately. And so by the time you get that, the minivan is full. And the only seats left are the two in the front, all for one little baby. It's a lot of headache and a lot of problem. And then as they grow up and as they start doing more, you realize it doesn't really go down from there. It just keeps going up. You can have the house perfectly clean. Everything put away. And the first thing they do is take the toy box and just dump it. I gotta get my toys out. Because it's not right if my toys, now I'm not gonna play with those toys, but they just gotta be out. That's the way it is. That's where they are. So why did we do this in the first place? And then you look in the car and there's all these things that you have to do, and I'm sorry, Angela. So, we've got some people having babies. Maybe I shouldn't have said any of this. But why did we do that? We wanted the child. We didn't want the problems. All those things just come with it. They're part of having the child. But we wanted the relationship. We wanted the child. We wanted to have this child that we could teach about family, that they could grow up. And yeah, in the beginning, we have to do absolutely everything for them. But, you know, it's not very long where they get to where, okay, we'll do this all. And then you get to the I do it myself stage. You remember that one? I get dressed myself. One red sock, one blue sock, green pants, and an orange shirt. I mean, okay. You need some fashion sense here, but that doesn't kick in until teenagers. And then they'll give you fashion advice. But how do we do all these things? But you know what? The problems are small compared to the joy of having the family. We hope that's what they always know. And yes, the relationship changes once they get older and they start having grandkids. And you go, oh, that was the reason I had them. That's why. Because now they've got to pack everything in their car. And we realize that's what God is. He wants us. He isn't here just to fix all of our problems. But you know what? Sometimes we'll look at God and go, you know what? If you don't fix my problems, I'm not going to believe in you anymore. I'm going to disfellowship you. Because I don't want to have a God that doesn't fix everything for me. If it's a two-year-old, we call it a tantrum. I'm not sure what we call it at our age, but it is not pretty. God just says, I want this relationship with you. He is here to build people of faith, people who have holiness, people who have righteousness. And that's what God really wants out of us. If all we ever give God is our problems, then we've missed the point. He wants ourselves. That's the real focus. Romans chapter 8, there's a couple of passages that just speak so powerfully to how to overcome these kinds of things that God has done. Because the core of all of this is the gospel. Romans 8, he says, there is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their mind on the things of the Spirit. It's not just about having your life all straightened out so that now I've got all of the physical things in my life exactly where they're supposed to be. It's about starting at the place where it really needed to start. The fact that God is able to say that gospel that says God sends his Son and gives his life to set us free from any law, from anything, from any condemnation. And that's really what the gospel is all about. Sin is taken away and is put on Jesus, and Jesus is the one who makes us holy and sends the Holy Spirit into us in order to lead us and to guide us. And that righteousness and holiness is found by grace rather than by law, rather than by getting your whole life in order and all of your self-discipline is found because we just trust God, and we believe in God, and we form a covenant with God. The gospel says there's evil in the world because of sin. And we can rid our life of sin by Jesus Christ. We can't rid the world of sin. But we can fix us. We can rid our life of sin. And God will do that, and we can be clean, and we can be free from sin. And God says that's the beginning point. Because it is all dependent on that, and it all starts with us. We can live above the sin of the world and live in this glory and this righteousness of God. And we treat people with love and grace. He says just a bit further, but if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Does that sound like a way to conquer problems? He says, I'll give you life. I can raise somebody from the dead. Don't you think I can fix whatever you have going on? Because raising from the dead is so much bigger than where you are and what you have. And if you'll just trust me, and if you'll just focus on me, and if you'll just get this Spirit into your life, that's the way that we find all these things. I need to read verse 13. I didn't get it on the screen, but it says, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Just focus everything on the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. There is a way to deal with the addiction. There is a way to deal with the habit. There is a way to deal with all these things. But it is done by the Holy Spirit. It is not just a self-help. It's not greater willpower. It's not more discipline. Yeah, you're going to need those as well. But it is by the Holy Spirit and by your use of him. Fix yourself by your own willpower? Or do you realize it's by the gospel? By the surrender to God and what God makes of us, that we would give Christ our life so that God works through us, so that His Spirit works in us, so that He gives life to our mortal body, so that we are able to use that Spirit to put to death any deeds of the body, so that now we win. And we have that love and joy and peace and patience and self-control and kindness that everybody wanted in the first place, because it all begins with God. And I don't know where your life is. If you've been trying to do all the self-help, and I'm going to improve, and I'm going to be better, and I'm going to make resolutions and everything else, let me suggest you begin with God. If we can help with that, we really want to do that. Whether it's being baptized into Christ, whether it's repenting of sins, He forgives. And you can be clean right now. Would you come always stand and sing?